Dr. Sebastian Seung will speak about brain, future, humanity, and how to connect it all. And he will explain his own plan to do that. Professor Seung is a computational neuroscientist at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and author of Connectome, How the Brain's Wiring Makes Us Who We Are. He received his PhD in theoretical physics from Harvard University and formerly worked at Bell Laboratories. His laboratory at MIT has launched iWire, an online community that empowers the public to map neural connections by playing a game of coloring neural images. Welcome, and we can't wait to hear about connecting it all. Thank you.
Thank you, Renata. These days, people ask me questions because neuroscience has been in the news a lot lately. First, Europe funded the Human Brain Project to the tune of 1 billion euros. The goal is to create a simulation of a human brain in the next decade. And then Obama, of course, announced the Brain Initiative just a little while ago. And so I actually have a history in brain simulation. I started out as a theoretical physicist, and then I switched to theoretical neuroscience. And I grew a little disenchanted with brain simulation because I felt like we didn't have enough data to ground our models in reality. And so the transformation that neuroscience is going through, to sum it up, I looked around on the internet and I found this image. So you may remember, you may be old enough to remember, that in the olden days, teenage boys with not a lot of money and too much time on their hands would fuss around with their hi-fi systems instead of play with the iPhones and other kinds of technologies that we know today. And our obsession then was high fidelity. And this is a, I don't know when the last time is that I touched a cassette tape, but far outlasting the cassette tape is this timeless advertising campaign from the 80s, which emphasized how good the fidelity of Maxell cassette tapes was in producing audio. And this is the crucial issue for neuroscience today. Can we record from more neurons, more signals, possibly every neuron in an organism? Can we map out all the connections inside a neural network? Can we know all the genes that every neuron in a brain is expressing? If we could do that, then our thinking, our models, our understanding of the brain would be high fidelity, and we wouldn't have to rely upon speculations and theories and things that can't be tested, things that are not necessarily really, really hard science. So the Human Brain Project, which focuses on simulation, I'm a little skeptical of it. I remember a friend of mine who worked on screenplays in Hollywood. I asked her what Hollywood was like, and she said, well, it's like high school, but with money. And the Human Brain Project, I would characterize as, well, it's like computational neuroscience, but with money. So I think that our neuroscientist in chief is on the right track because he's really all about building the right technologies to give us that high fidelity model of what the brain really does. Okay, so I was recently in the White House, and people often ask me, I was in the White House for that announcement, people ask me, so what is the Brain Initiative supposed to do? And I guess when you actually get close to government, you sort of realize what happens, which is that nobody knows. He sort of said, okay, you guys do something. And now there's committee after committee after committee deciding what should be done with that money. But one of the things that will happen is to understand the structure of the brain at a really, really high resolution. So in fact, rather than talk about entire brains, one thing that my lab focuses on is the retina. The retina is technically a part of the brain, but it's an approachable part of the brain. It's been displaced out into the eye. It doesn't just have photoreceptors, it doesn't just receive light, but it also does basic visual computations. So there's neurons in the retina besides the photoreceptors. And that was known already a century ago. So this famous neuroscientist, 1906 Nobel laureate, Santiago Ramón y Cajal, was looking at the retina. It was one of his favorite topics. He spent he wrote a whole book on the retina, and he described its neurons, its cells, with these beautiful drawings. You can see the one on the right here. And already you can see that Cajal was very clearly cognizant of the fact that the retina was not just receiving sensory impressions, but it was actually doing some of the visual perception itself. He noted there was all this kind of neural machinery inside the retina, and you wouldn't need all that complexity if it was just receiving signals and not doing anything with them. Now, we know that there are 50 to 100 types of retinal neurons. So this is kind of a shocker to some people. When you hear about neurons, you think, oh, a neuron is a neuron is a neuron. But in fact, there's incredible diversity of neurons. There's more types of cells in the brain than there are in all other organs and tissues in the body put together. Right? So, you know, you think about liver cells, heart cells, and so on. But inside the brain itself is a huge diversity. And it's kind of like the biodiversity you would see in the rainforest, because neurons look like trees. And so you can see this cartoon here of 50, or nobody really knows. It's like biodiversity in the sense that nobody knows how many there are. Nobody knows how many species or types of neurons there are inside the retina, and certainly not inside the brain. People estimate 50 to 100 types. And they have these all these kinds of diverse shapes. And every time scientists have looked, they found that each one of these types of neurons has a different function. So a different function of visual perception. One might be important for color perception. One might be important for detecting motion, and so on and so forth. And so this is just a preview of the kind of complexity that is going to be mapped out inside the brain. So how do we do this? Well, these days, with very advanced microscopes, one can take very high resolution images of a retina. So we're talking about, say, 20 nanometer pixels, and it's a huge amount of data. So how do we analyze it? Well, we have artificial intelligence to help us, but unfortunately, AI is not perfect, right? So robots can't see as well as humans still, and so we need people to help us, and that's why we created this website called iWire, iWire.org, which mobilizes the public to come and volunteer to be amateur neuroscientists. So they can log in. So you can see it right here, right? So here's this neuron. Its branches are being traced out by our amateur neuroscientists. And on the right-hand side, you see the leaderboard. So it's a game. And they get points. And you can see it's fairly international. I don't know. There's the number one scorer there. It looks like that's an Italian flag, a New Zealand flag, and so on. And there's a global chat where they get social on the left. And so I'll show you how to log in. So you go to your web browser and you log in. There it is. Looks better if we have a bigger screen, but so we can only see a few people on the leaderboard. We have 27 people logged in right now. And we could start playing. And here's a cube of the retina. This is just 6 microns on a side, so 10 times thinner than a hair. And the artificial intelligence has colored in part of the branch of a neuron, but it lost the trail right there. I don't know if you could see it, but it's a very thin branch, and it lost the trail, so we can help it by clicking here. Okay, we're out of the woods. We found the rest of that branch. You see it right there. And then you submit that cube, and multiple people do each cube, and they get compared with each other in order to, so we can get really accurate results. And so the first thing that we found, we launched this in private beta in February 2012, and our official launch was in December. We have 60,000 registered users so far, maybe more now, 60,000 as of a month ago. And so the first thing that we found was that some people really like this, right? It's a very simple thing. I guess all of you have liked coloring at some point in your life. And so this is a 3D coloring book. And so when we ask people why they like it, they say, well, it's kind of relaxing. So some people say it's like watching the clouds or like watching a lava lamp. And there's a competitive element too, right? So there's the leaderboard. And so I kind of knew we had something when last year, one evening I asked my girlfriend a question and she said, don't bother me, I'm finishing a neuron. And that's when I discovered that in spite of her mild-mannered demeanor, she's actually extremely vicious competitor. And she would play this game every night until she became number one, and then she would collapse in exhaustion. So there's some competitive people out there. And she actually had this duel with Jose from Spain. And it was very annoying to her because every night she would go to bed number one, but she would wake up and he would be number one because he was 6 hours ahead in Spain. So this is actually gotten some testimonials. So email from an iWire, I must say how much I'm loving iWire. I never imagined there would be ways I could actually make a tiny contribution to real scientific discovery. It's a wonderful way to pass the hours, listening to science podcasts while I map neurons. iWire has become an important part of my life, and I feel a sense of responsibility for it, as well as personally gaining greatly from it. And surprisingly, this game can be pretty addictive. So my girlfriend, and luckily our relationship survived, she's now my wife, and she's not number one anymore, because now the teenage gamers have come in, the ones who play shoot 'em up games and got bored with them. And so here's one, here's Mouse Hawk. We watch the chat for funny things like this. Damn, I've been sitting here for 4 hours now. I'm cold and hungry, but I can't leave it. And here's another one from a high school kid. Last night, my mom told me to go to bed, and I was like, but mom, I'm mapping. Then I kept mapping until 2 a.m. So somehow the image of this little kid disobeying his mom to do neuroscience research is kind of hilarious. And people find little pieces of neurons that look like funny things. Like, for example, did you know that there's little men walking around the retina? And every community has its goths. And sometimes iWire is not kid safe. All right, so why do we have iWire? Well, we're mapping out connections in the retina because we want to understand how the retina works in visual perception. And I've explained the motivation for mapping out connections in this book called Connectome. So Connectome is this new word. It's like the genome, but for the brain. It's a structural description of the brain. You could think about it like a flight, right? Visualize the flight map in the back of the airline magazines with all the cities and the flights. Well, imagine that with 100 billion cities and 10,000 flights per city. That's something like the connectome for your brain. Okay, so what do we discover with iWire? With iWire, you know, is it just a game? Is it actually helping us do science? Well, we've made some interesting discoveries about the retina, and we're currently preparing it for publication. I'll give you a little bit of a flavor for it. So here's a particular kind of neuron. It's called a J-type ganglion cell. So this type of cell was discovered in 2008 at Harvard, and it's an output cell of the retina. So it sends its axon to the brain. It sends signals to the brain. And we know that it detects motion. So if you pass a spot of light from left to right across its branches, then it responds. If you pass the spot of light in the other direction, it doesn't respond. So it's selective for motion. And of course, detecting motion is a very important function for any animal that's visual, right? Because it has to either run away from predators or catch prey and so on. Now, surprisingly though, although direction selectivity in the retina has been known for a long time, nobody knew how that happened, right? It's one thing to say that neurons are direction selective, and it's another to actually understand the mechanisms. And this is a big problem, right? Because people tell you they want to cure mental disorders. On the one hand, neuroscience, they promise that. But on the other hand, neuroscientists can't explain why a neuron would be selective for one direction of motion and not the other. It's like the most trivial thing. So it's kind of a disconnect between what people expect from neuroscience and what neuroscientists can actually do. So I found this picture on the internet, which is it can keep this in your mind as a mental image of what this neuron resembles. And here's one thing we've discovered about this neuron. which is that it gets excitatory inputs from another kind of neuron called bipolar cells. So bipolar cells have distinctive shapes. They're much smaller, and so you can see there's a yellow one and there's a pink, there's a magenta one underneath this neuron. And these are cells of the same type, but interestingly, because of the shape of this neuron, the cell on the left, its dendrites, its axon intermingles with the J dendrites and connects with it, and the cell on the right doesn't. Right? So the cells are of the same type, but depending on their location, one connects and the other one doesn't. And the one on the right doesn't because it's missing the branches, right? So you can see that I showed you the shape, and this shape has implications for the connections. The one on the right's not connecting. And in general, there are, say, 10 types of bipolar cells in the retina. And it turns out that that cell that is connecting to the left side of the J cell is one that has a time delay. So it, when visual signals come in, it passes them on with a time delay. And that's important for motion detection, right? Because this is actually a very old model of motion detection. So imagine that you've got two signals coming into a coincidence detector, and suppose that one of those signals is on a delay line. So it takes time for it to get to right here. So there's the delay line right there. That means if I stimulate this input first and this input second, because of this delay, the signals will reach here at the same time. But if I stimulate here first and here second, then the signals will arrive at very different times. So here we have a very simple mechanism of temporal order. So AB will cause the neuron to respond, but BA won't. And that probably is a way in which motion detection is happening in the cell. And this is a kind of puzzle that has actually eluded neuroscientists for about 50 years, figuring out how direction selectivity happens in the retina. Okay, and so we are planning more projects involving the public, more websites, citizen science projects. So the one that's currently in the works is about reading memories. So we have a piece of a mouse brain, and the mouse has actually has stored a memory of an association between an odor and fear. It's learned to fear that odor, and so we're going to look at the connections in its olfactory system, collectively look at the connections, and try to find out whether we can read out that memory. And then after that, searching for connectopathy. So one of the oldest theories in neuroscience is that certain mental disorders come from miswiring, that the neurons are perfectly healthy, but they're wired together in an abnormal way. So for example, epilepsy, autism, and schizophrenia have all been hypothesized to be connectopathies. So we're going to mobilize the public to look for those miswirings inside a piece of brain. And we're partnering with hospitals to use neurosurgical tissue. And we hope to partner with WGBH Nova and museums. So we've been talking with these people for a long time, and we're just looking for the right opportunity to create a partnership with Nova to reach high school students and also museums to reach the public. So thanks very much. It's a cycle, right? Because actually we use the human input to make our AI smarter through machine learning. So there's two putting together artificial intelligence and human intelligence has two points, right? One is to get useful results out of an AI that makes errors, and the other is to make the AI smarter. So depending on the rate of increase, it's really hard to predict how long it will take.